supportive and part of the civil society. As a politician, you've been supporting and playing different roles. So you also have a great understanding of how different civil society organization works for global justice and different thematic, including climate justice. So you're most welcome to start the day.
Does it work? Yes. It does?
Yes.
Close. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Yes, that's right. My name is Bodil Valero, and for the Swedes, you maybe not know me by that name. My name used to be Ceballos. But I remarried my first husband, and I went back to call myself Valero. So that's the reason why name change. Yes, you have been asking me to talk about climate justice and sustainability and give a little about the governmental view. I come from the Green Party. As you see, I'm in the European Parliament. I'm not in the Swedish government, but of course I have very close links to the Swedish government. The Swedish government is a minority government with the Social Democrats and the Green Party here in Sweden. So it's a rather tough time. But the Green Party, we are in charge of climate issues mostly, and also cooperation. So we do have a lot to say. And now, before the time in we're going to meet in Brussels, in Paris, we also have a government or the presidency of the European Union, where the Green Party is a member of government. And I know that the Luxembourgish presidency, they take the climate change issues very, very, very in an important way. So I believe that we have a strong European position this time. If we look at back to 2009, when we were in Copenhagen, and it was the Swedish presidency. There were no Greens in that government at all. And the Swedish presidency had the idea that we should not have any specific position, because we were just going to coordinate the different member countries in the European Union. So we coordinated, we did not stand out for climate or for the developing countries in that case. And this will not be the case this time, I'm sure about that. I've had several meetings. I've met the Luxembourgish presidency several times, and I know that they take this very, very seriously. And so do the Swedish government this time. And if we look at the negotiations, the European Union is in the forefront, if we compare with others. The Swedish government is in the forefront, also in the European Union, to strive for a better climate change, that we want to be binding, etc. I will come to the demands from the Swedish government in the end of my presentation. So, I hope we will get some better results this time, but what I heard from the negotiation from inside is that for the moment there is only a list of what the different countries they declare they are accepting to contribute with. And this list, they have to make a text out of it until October, next meeting. And what we also have seen for the moment is that the list of proposals from the different countries, it's not enough to reach the 2% 2 degree goal. So there is a lot of work to be done. And it's therefore it's also so very important that the civil society is very active in all countries, all over the world, to put pressure on their governments. So I hope that we can work together from the political point of view and from civil society to really get our governments on top, to make this top agenda. Okay, I start with this picture. Because we all know what is happening, we can see it, we can feel it. We have much more flooding, floodings, and much more drought. We have very heavy weather changes, and we can see it now. When we Greens started as a party more than 30 years ago, we spoke about climate change and everybody were laughing at us. Now nobody's laughing any longer. So this has been a big change. With the water, I wanted to show the different weather, or the weather changes, and the people walking there, because people, they really have to leave their homes because of the weather changes, because of the climate change. And we know that climate changes is a very, very driving force for migration, and also for security and conflicts, or bad security and conflicts. In the European Parliament, I do not work in the cooperation committee. I do. We have it under observation, but we are not. We have four Greens in the European Parliament, and we have shared the different topics between us. I'm in the committee which deals with migration, but I'm the spokesperson for the Green group in the Parliament for defence and security. I also work in foreign affairs, and this is, everything is mixed. I do not work so much on climate, except for in the case of the foreign affairs. But that is also what I work with in the Swedish Parliament, because during 8 years in the Swedish Parliament, I was the spokesperson of foreign affairs for the Greens. And our main topic in foreign affairs is climate change. Because if we do not solve this crisis that we have, then we will have a lot of conflicts, a lot of poverty, and the migration flows that will not be possible to control at all. So, but I know that you all have known this is, I don't understand this this computer. Mellan slots. Okay. I'm sure you all have seen what is happening from the IPCC reports, etc. We can see that the globally temperature on land and ocean surface, it's growing. And if you look at back to the 2007 IPCC report, then the scientists, they didn't agree on everything. For example, they didn't agree on how much the sea level would rise, or if it would rise so much. So it was not in the former IPCC report. But now we do know that this is the case, that the sea levels, they are going to rise, and the scientists, they are more aware of them. And then I would like to connect to what's happening up in the north of our globe, in the Arctic. The old ice has nearly disappeared. In wintertime, yes, we can get a rather big ice up there, but in the summertime it's very, very little. And that is because the old ice, the real ice, has gone, and it's only the new one. But for the moment, all of the oil companies and the countries up in the north, they are trying to exploit the gas and oil that they can find below the ice. And this is a struggle that we have to stop that, because all fossil fuels that stay in the ground is the best fossil fuel. Because what happens when the ice melts up in the north? Well, people in the south, they suffer. If you look at Bangladesh, for example, when the sea level rises, what will happen in Bangladesh? How many people will have to leave their homes to go to some other place, in Bangladesh or elsewhere? I'm in something that is called the ACP delegation in the European Parliament. It's a joint parliamentary assembly with the countries of Africa, Caribbean, and the Pacific. And in June, we went to Fiji. And I spoke to the president of Kiribati. And they're already buying land in Fiji so they can evacuate their population in case needed. what they believe. They are sure they will have to evacuate, or at least they have bought land to be able to produce their food. Because, of course, they can move up to the mountains, but where are they going to produce their food? So, everything that we can do not to use the fossil fuels, the new fossil fuel that they can find up there, will help to save the situation for people in the south. And also before, we always said, okay, this is a level we can use, we have to reduce our levels of fossil fuels here up in the north, and the people in the south, they can higher their levels. And that should be true, of course, but we didn't do what we had to do. During all those years that we have been saying this is the case, we could do this, and now we are in a situation where we have to say to Mozambique and to other countries, well, it's not that good if you use your fossil fuels that you have here. We should think in other ways. We should try to help you with clean energy, things like that. Because we are all in the same boat for the moment. And this is a very, very difficult discussion. We are the ones up here in the north who produce this problem. We have to pay. Not all countries want to pay. But we have to do that. And that is also the position of the Swedish government in this case. And the Swedish government says directly that it will be on the side of the countries with the worst consequences, who suffers the most of the consequences of climate change, now in the discussions. And here we also see the greenhouse gas concentration. I will pass this very, very quickly. It's very technical. But this one, we also know that these are also from the IPCC report, I believe. You can see up there how the temperature is changing very, very much. Up in the north where I live, where we live, we will get much warmer weather, but it's very changing. It could be very cold sometimes, and then much hotter in other times. But we also see the changes in temperature or in the precipitation, the rain and so on. And it's not a very good, it should be better, but we can also see that it's changing very much. The Spanish government, they made a vulnerability assessment a couple of years ago, when after the 2007 IPCC report, I believe it was. And they said that in 2030, the temperature in the Spanish peninsula could be in summertime around 50 degrees. And who will go to Spain for vacations with 50 degrees in summertime? Spain, the main industry in Spain is tourism. Who will be there? I believe that Spanish won't stay there either. Sometimes. So, and how are they going to produce any food with such temperatures? This is an assessment, could be like that, maybe it will not. But we have to face the possible consequences and to adapt to them. We know that the IPCC report said that the global warming is caused by human beings, our activities. We know that they are happening.
Sorry, would you mind to tell us what IPCC is?
Just it's an International Panel on Climate Change.
Yeah. Good. From the Thank UN. You.
95% sure that the human activities is the main reason why we have this warming that we have now. Other reasons are volcanoes and things like that, but the main reason are the human activities. We know that they are happening, the climate change is happening, we can feel it, we can see it every day. And then we have to decide, what are we going to do? What are we going to do to mitigate and we have to adapt to a new climate. We have to do a lot of adaptation to cope with a new climate. We know that. And the rich countries, they can afford to do it. But the poorer countries, they have much more difficulties to do so. And we have to work much faster if we will not reach the 2-degree goal. And in one assessment I read, it was said that what we now have promised to do, then we will reach 4 degrees. So we will have to do a lot more than we did before. And this sounds very, very terrible, of course, but we can also see that we are in time. These are the planetary boundaries. And some of them we have already passed, where we cannot go back, where it's already destroyed. But when it comes to climate change, we are still on an uncertainty level, as it's called here. There is a big risk that we can pass the threshold, and if we pass the threshold, we cannot go back. So, but we are in time, and that is what we have to the starting point in some way. We have to do whatever we can not to pass that threshold. And that's also where we have to work all together. And the consequences, of course. Yeah, here we can put a lot of other things into it. Yeah? So if you have any good ideas, I will try to put something else there. But this is, for example, migration. Anybody has an idea of how many climate migrants we have already? I think it was 1990 that the UN said that we had already 25 million. Yeah, and we will see the figure we see mostly, it's about 200 million that we will see in the future. And this means that one of the main consequences of climate change is that people will have to migrate. We will see a lot of people migrate. We will have instability because of this. We will have food shortages because we cannot produce any longer. It's not here on the list. I don't know why, but it's not there. In the, a lot of conflicts between people. And we can see that already, I will come to that also. And then, of course, a lot of poverty. And it's not only because of floodings or the drought and so on that makes people run away from their homes. It can also be cooperation sometimes. If we want to, and good things like clean energy, if we want to build a dam, water dam, to get electricity and for irrigation or for a lot of other things, good things that we need to adapt to climate change also, or to mitigate. Then every time we build a new dam, I think there is more or less an average of 40,000 people that have to leave their homes. So the big dams, bigger dams, more people, small dams, less people. So it's also, there's a lot of people leaving their homes because we want to do something good also. But the migration is very, very, very wide, I could say, and for different reasons. But many, many people are going to leave their homes. They say, 200 million climate migrants could be 2050 already. And what we already have, the current estimates, we cannot say how much really, between 25 million and 1 billion people by 2050. Then we have a problem also, because people, they are not always staying in their home countries when they migrate. Sometimes they come somewhere else, and climate refugee, it's not something you can ask for according to the Geneva Convention on refugees. So you cannot apply for a political asylum or to be a person in need. Just because of climate change. In Sweden, we have an article in the Swedish law, in the Swedish Farmers Act, where it says that you can also, a refugee of an environmental refugee, where I believe that the climate refugees would also be part of, we can take environmental refugees to Sweden. I don't think we have ever used it, except for one occasion. It was temporary that people from El Salvador could come here after the earthquake a couple of years or many years ago already. So, but we are the only country, as far as I know, that has any article in our legislation talking about climate or environmental refugees. So this is something that we have to work on. And there is also one family from Tuvalu, who got residency in New Zealand, according to a court decision, I think. Then we have also the recent conflicts. We have, for example, he's missing some of the countries, I see. Sudan, we have there is also a draw. We have the Horn of Africa, where also the droughts and the climate is a driving factor for the conflicts. But what we see in Syria, for example, before the war broke out in Syria, they had 5 years of drought. And 1.5 million people from Syria had already left their homes and they were migrants in their own country. And then this, of course, leads to instability in the country and conflict between people and with them. So this is really a driving force for conflict. And this is also what the research says. We find strong causal evidence linking climatic events to human conflict across a range of spatial and temporal scales and across all major regions of the world. And then we have to go to COP21, Paris, and we come to the Swedish government's view on this. The overall goal, you can read it here, or I read it out loud if it's too small. Sweden's overall goal is that the climate meeting in Paris in 2015 will result in a global, fair, and legally binding climate agreement that contributes to over time keep global warming as far below 2 degrees as possible. And this strategy rests on three pillars. Sweden should be a leading country and sharpen its national climate policy. Sweden also works to make the EU raise its ambition for emission reductions. And this is about what do we do in our own countries, because we have to reduce our emissions. And when I compare Sweden to other countries in the European Union, I always feel proud, both in migration issues and in climate issues. Because we have done a lot, and we continue to do a lot, we have some difficulties. Yesterday I met the secretary of our vice prime minister, Åsa Romson. And there, she was in Brussels and struggling with the commission defending our tax on carbon. Yeah. Because we are not supposed to have that. But if we do, so we have to struggle with the European Union because they say this is not a fair competition, because then the petrol is in disadvantage and so on. And we should not, but yeah, it's a struggle we have. We take that struggle, and we have the Swedish government and the other Swedish parties with us in this. So we have to do a lot because we have to lower our emissions. And the new climate agreement needs to be dynamic so that countries' binding emission targets can be increased over time also. Because as we see now, some of the countries say, okay, we can do this, we can do to this level, but it has to be possible always to be better and better. And the new good agreement is only possible if willing countries cooperate. And Sweden will prioritize cooperation with countries that also want to see an ambitious agreement and those that are most vulnerable to climate impacts. And these are the three pillars of the Swedish government and how they work in the climate negotiations. We have the commissioner is from Spain, the one who is dealing with climate change in for the negotiations. He has a very clear mandate from President Juncker that climate change is an important task and he has to do a good job. But it's also a person with a lot of interest in the petrol industry. He's a Spaniard and he has been working, he was the environmental minister and he changed the laws. He really destroyed everything that was environmental friendly, you could say. So I'm not very, very convinced that he is the best person to negotiate, but of course he has to fulfill his what President Juncker tells him to do and what the member countries tells him to do. He's also a person who thinks that shale gas is one of the major possibilities for you for the energy security in Europe. So I'm not very, very confident anyway about the results when he's there. So we have really to see to well put that pressure on our governments, and I hope that the Luxembourg presidency are tough, especially with a commissioner like that. And then that was it for me, I think, for the moment. And well, you find me there, that address, and I didn't do this. It was Lena, my assistant.
Thank you so much, Bodil. And thank you for giving us some of the hard facts. We've been talking about that the last days, the need of also having evidence and using the good research that is out there. Because when we claim, pose our demands on governments and parliaments, we need to also have our facts in order, right? So now it's time to invite some of our friends here, some of our partner organizations for the Swallows, who've been helping us to make this conference interesting and full with examples and reflections from particularly Bangladesh and India, and sometimes also from Uruguay. So now let me invite. Sorry, I just need my other glasses. Sorry. But from Keystone Foundation, one of the co-founders, I'm happy to invite Mathew, John, to the stage, please. And also Sukanta Sen from BARCIK in Bangladesh. Welcome back. I think Mathew, this is the first time you're on stage, right now? Yeah, on the, yeah, sorry, but in this room. So, but a special warm welcome to you. And last but not least, Shahidul, welcome you back from Unnayan, Dhara, also in Bangladesh. And the three of you will give some general reflections and comments. I'll ask you to be quite brief so we can have a good discussion and hopefully also invite some of the audience with some reflections. But so, some 3 minutes. And then if you can pose some specific questions to Bodil, we'll start the discussion from there and see. So Mathew, why don't you start?
Okay.
And each of you have a mic there.
Thank you, Bodil. I think what was great was the way you put down the issues very clearly and very, especially for lay people, when there's a discussion on climate change, most people get lost in graphs and figures, and in trying to explain that. And so for an audience, I think it was very clear and very helpful to understand at an overall global level. For my reflections, I was just thinking back, and I tried to look at the Indian government and the kind of efforts that it has been making on climate change. It's on top of the Indian government's agenda, and there are many efforts that are going on at the Indian level. There's a huge amount of money that is put aside for sustainable agriculture, what they call. There's also a huge amount for what they call greening India, and that's amount of money put aside. There's also work on energy efficiency, and so the government is putting these things together. What I sometimes we fail to see is when these sort of missions are working, where is the linkage between all of them? You know, so each one of them tends to work in isolation, and sometimes I'm not very sure whether in Europe also whether there is a linkage between different ministries and and whether they are able to put things together, because in isolation we have maybe something good coming out, but what happens together? A huge matter of concern, actually, in an Indian context, is our growing population, especially in the middle class, and their aspirations are booming. Over the last 15, 20 years that I've seen, they are on par, they would like the perks, the benefits that are available to their peers all over the world. And so whether you take it in the IT sector, whether you take it in the financial services sector, they are all over. And that group is aspiring for many things which they see in the West. Their requirements in terms of habitat, their requirements in terms of if they look at automobiles, in terms of technology, in terms of the best that they can have. And so the amount of energy required to fulfill those is sometimes, you know, we have figures just floating around, it just says out of the total population of 1,200 million, we have a middle class population of over 300 million. And so when I hear discussions in Europe or in Sweden about steps being taken, and I just try and think back as to what does it mean for my own country? You know, these steps suddenly seem very small compared to, you know, the scale at which it has to be addressed in our own countries. And so sometimes that's a huge challenge. Also, I think one huge thing that comes up in India is we're more like a continent. So when you look at your European Parliament and you have a push and pull there, I mean, our states are at the same level. You know, just the state I come from, it has a population of close to 70 million, and it's one third the size of Sweden. And then, I mean, I say, where are we going to put the efforts to be able to make an impact on climate change? So, for me, these are just questions that I'm thinking back, and so. The question that I would like to put to you is when Sweden is making such proactive steps in its own country and in the European Parliament, where does it see itself engaging with economies like India? You know, where we have to come to a solution somewhere, and how do we come to that when constantly this whole thing of, you know, the Indian government says that the West has done what it wanted to do, and it's now asking us to reduce, you know, this thing. So even if there is a reduction just in terms of multiplication by population, everything goes out of the window, you know. And so how does Sweden or Europe propose to engage in very concrete steps to be able to dialogue at a government level, at a community level where our work is? And with those communities, I see actually their impact is literally 0.00 somewhere, you know, because their aspirations, their wants are extremely small, you know. I mean, I can just give, they work, some of the communities that we work with, they work only when they need to. And so some of the companies, they have a difficulty getting people to work. Because people in the community say, I have enough for this week. I will come back to you next week if I need more. Well, that's the level at which some of the communities are. But at a national scale, the issue becomes mind-boggling. And so some of these reflections to you, and hopefully we'll have a dialogue more on this later. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mathew. So, yeah, you're comparing scales here. Sweden has 9 million, right?
Yeah.
Shahidul, what are your reflections?
Yeah, thank you for a nice presentation and our view of what is happening at global level regarding climate change. I would like to focus on our grassroots perspective. I especially work with sustainable agriculture. In the area of Bangladesh, where we are in threat of desertification due to climate change. And in other areas of Bangladesh, especially coastal area, very much under threat. When you are talking about consequences of climate change, migration, instability, human rights, conflicts, poverty, I was looking linked with food sovereignty we are working with, the consequence on agriculture, and which will affect the food sovereignty or security of the people, poor people. When we are talking about consequences, then you have to find out the causes of this kind of migration or instability. When people are hungry, they have no livelihood options, then they are not willing to migrate until or unless they have this kind of ensure food and shelter, this kind of thing. So it would be, I was expecting more from you, more on this kind of removing the causes of migration, rather solving the problem of migrated people. What are your plan or the plan global level? I know the major issues also discussed in the global level, that how to solve this problem of migration, migrated people. But in cause level, what our government or other multilateral donors are doing in our country. My understanding is that those are not going right way. For example, in case of food security, increasing food production, where the perception coming from outside with GM seeds and this kind of technologies that will solve the food production problem or add up to climate change. But you know, climate change is okay, but at the same time, to solve the disaster problem or changing problem in ecosystem, we have to have ecosystem-based production system. You have to better manage the ecosystem to have better production. In that sense, our sustainable agriculture that we had before Green Revolution, we need to move more focus on that. But we are at global level, the policymaker focusing more on second generation Green Revolution or third generation. So I would like to have your comments on this.
Sorry, my mic was up. Okay, thank you, Shahidul. So, Sukanta, let's hear from you.
Thanks for your presentations and how you described how the Swedish government or EU is thinking. But before actually climate change, it will be happen. It happens always and it will be happen more. But maybe there will be lots of migration, as you mentioned. Estimated there will be 100,000 migrants will be all over the world. And climate negotiation will be happen in the coming months, that is. And we hope that there will be lots of discussions. And finally, I hope that there should be. But at the same time, when we talk about the climate change, at the same time, it's okay. If it is happen, then how we will migrate all those people who are now, due to the war, that US and silent support from EU, other countries, which is happening now all over the Middle East, that lots of hundred thousands migrants are coming forward to EU countries. And that's also the migrants, or anyway, or the displaced people, those who are not due to the climate change, due to the war. And yeah, at the same time, people, those who are coming from Bangladesh, who came here to work in Middle East, they are also coming back. And we know that as a small country, we have lots of displacement. It's not only the climate change, but the ecological destruction happened over the last 40 or more time. And we are surrounded by India. We have problem not only the global level, but we have to face the problem also the India. Because the freshwater flow, which is mostly affected, which is really politically controlled by the Indian government, and we face in the drought, and due to the monsoon, we face the flood, and also in the coal mining in some parts of in the northern part of the India, now our wetlands are going filled with by sands, so people are displaced from that regions. So, and also in the south are the climate, reducing industrial shrimp farming. Thousands of people already displaced. It's not due to the climate change at all. But if the, really the climate change has happened, then how Bangladesh will be able to survive? Or how will be able to keep all those peoples? Because we know the conflict, you also mentioned the conflict. And we have also a small study about the resource conflict, what has happened here. Just after 2007 Ayla, which is the cyclone was happening, the peoples from one area, they came to other areas, in a small village, or in a small union, is the lowest administrative unit in Bangladesh. That the authority, they don't have much resources, adequate resources, to help other additional peoples. So conflict is there. So conflict is not due to the war, but conflict is also the resource conflict, or the climate conflict. And you have mentioned that it's okay, we can hope that there will be something to happen in COP, which was not happening in Copenhagen. But of course, we think that it's okay, because you will take the roles. And you have already agreed that achieve a legally binding and universal agreement on climate change, aim of keeping global warming below 2 degrees Celsius. We hope that at least it would be happen. Yeah? And also from your level, that you also agreed that to reduce 40% of greenhouse gas, as you mentioned, emission, then 1990 by 2030. So lots of things you are in planning. But when it really in the discussion level and or in the negotiation process, that finally nothing has happened. Though all over the year, there are lots of discussion like strategic planning, subsidiary bodies meeting, lots of things happen. But at the same time, when we think that it's okay, you also mentioned the fossil fuel. Like you know that Bangladesh also doing, Bangladesh is going to construct, is already in plan and is approved by the government. The thermal power plant is very close to the Sundarban area, which is joining with India. And thermal plant, they will use the coal. And you also mentioned that carbon emission due to the Golan, and it's pretty close to the Sundarban, which is also impact on 14 kilometers far from only Sundarban area. And Indian, joint Indian government and Bangladesh working together. And recently also the German foreign minister and also France minister recently visited Bangladesh jointly, and they also agreed the expressed that yes, so they will help together to fight climate changes. Just before the day before yesterday, because now the thermal plant is going to be constructed. And it was in bidding process, three companies actually submitted for construction as a bidder. And one of the French companies also there, that they are interested also to construct that building. So at the same time, when we're talking about the climate change, one of the solution, but the solution in one way, that is not the real solution. It's like one with a false solution. Yeah, that's because we have the problem, and as you mentioned also, you have also created a problem, but we don't think that we have not created. We have also some responsibility, because man-made, when you think man-made, it is also, I mean, man, I have some responsibility there, that anyway, I have some contribution, which is very low area. So how we can think that it will not be any way of a corporate social responsibility, that you have created a problem, now you can give us some money to survive. Rather, how we can think that as a polluter's base principle, that you are also in a thinking in a way that yes, okay, you have created the problem. You have taken some responsibility. How we can remove that problem that my colleagues also mentioned, that and in what way that you are thinking that like Bangladesh can get justice, not like some money that you have already supported, like Swedish government already supported in our climate change resilience fund and to implement our climate change strategy action plan that we have developed in 2009, and also comprehensive disaster management program already is now going to the second phase. First phase and second phase we have also supported. So that's a very good way that you are keeping us. But what way is really the peoples of Bangladesh, like other vulnerable countries, can get really justice due to the climate? Because we also need the justice. We don't need only the fund that we'll keep going or we'll survive, because peoples in our country know how to survive. From the boyhood, I know how to survive in my own country, because I was grown up in rural area. I found that how we are able to survive, because yes, okay, climate change is there, but we have lots of difficulties. Ecological destruction, flood, everything is there happening.
Okay, Sukanta, yes. Thank you. I'll stop you there, and I know that you have much more issues, so let's come back. So give Bodil a chance to, I mean, you widen the complexity here, and you also raise new questions. And I know there's a lot of questions that were not raised by you, so if you're not going to raise them, I'm going to raise them. But first, Bodil,
I'll start with your question about the middle class, and that's a reality, and we have to face it. And when we have been looking to the emissions before, we say, okay, this is what we per capita can emit, and the world will survive if we all do the same. But when we then look at the middle class in many countries, that many emerging countries or the middle class, they do use much, much more than we do here, for example. When I went to India or to the Dominican Republic, and I went to a meeting, and it was very, very hot outside, and in the meeting inside with the air conditioner at 16 degrees and a little freezing, and you get a cold and you really get bad. And also with talking to people, and they say, but I need this big car. I have to have this big car. In a journalist in the Dominican Republic, I mean, oh, it would be denigrating. Can you have that? How do you call that? Denigrating to go by bus, as we do. But I think that's what we have to do, because in India, in Bangladesh, everywhere in the world, the people have this right to live as well as we do here. And we do live very well. What we have done here is to change the fuel. we still have petrol and so on, but in our houses, for example, that we did use a lot of fossil fuels to heat our houses. There is nearly nothing left of fossil fuels to heat houses. We do really need to heat our houses here. But we have reduced it. We have biofuels, or we take the air from outside. We have it's not so much wind power, but we have water. We have still the nuclear power. We do not like it, but we want to take it out little by little. But so if we can live very well and still be friendly to our environment. And that's the change we have made here, because otherwise we would have been very high up also when we look at their personal level. So that's what I believe that we have to work with in the country where the middle class claims to have a better life, and that's normal. And I do support that 100% or 200%, because we have all the right to live equally and work. So if we do change a bit the mindset, we do not have to make the same mistakes in developing countries as we already made, because we know now what are the consequences. So try to help you to do it right from the beginning. And I know Sweden has cooperation mostly with the poorest countries, and that's the idea. And for democracy, human rights, climate. So you can also, we have some cooperation also with India, but it's more by civil society. And I think that's a problem also, because we could do much more. And we have been rather bad at selling in our ideas in countries where we are not with a common cooperation. Because we have a lot of good technology here in Sweden, environmental, we have a lot of innovators and so on who produce a lot of good things, but we have been very, very bad at selling this idea to others. So then those who are selling the solar cells and so on are Spaniards or other European countries, but not Sweden. I think we could do much more to help to address this situation. Then it's when it comes to migration, as you said, but both of you were talking about it. The root causes, that's the most important thing. And that is not addressed now in the COP21, but we do work on it very, very much on the European level now, because we have that big influx of people coming from Syria, from the war zones and so on. So, and then this was an idea that from the Swedish side, from the Swedish parliament, we have told the European Union for a long time that we have to work on the root causes. Because if we do not work on poverty reduction, if we do not work on the conflict resolution, if we do not work on climate change, people will have to leave their countries. So we have to work with that. But the European Union is a very egoistic union, you could say also. In many cases it's like that. They've been looking more at our interest, our own interest. Yeah? So if it's good for us, we can help, otherwise we do not. And the migration has been something, until now, there have been a lot of people drowning in the Mediterranean and on the Atlantic for many years already. And it's now when Europe starts to act, because now it's a chaotic situation. And now we do talk about that we have to work together with a foreign affairs instruments that we have, with the cooperation and other things that we have, diplomacy and everything, and with the internal. It's now when they start to talk about, but it has taken a long time. And then many times, for example, France, they can go to some other country and say, well, we can help you with your energy situation because we can build you a nuclear power plant. And then they take it from the cooperation level. I do not agree that you should take cooperation money to build something that can destroy more than it builds up. I think it's double standards, double moral, what you are talking about with Germany and others to help the coal plant. They should come and give to the possibilities to build up clean energy instead of bad energy. And that is a fight that we have all the time. We are not alone in the Swedish government either, and the Luxembourgish, they are not alone in their government. But we do try to do whatever we can to get the clean energies in, because we think it's the future. If we are all going to live good lives, we have to do it in a sustainable manner. And that's the only way that we can have justice between our countries. For in the moment, there is no justice. And it hasn't been for many, many years. We are living with the old colonial structures and something like those down there in the south, from the European side. And it's difficult to get that out of some of the parliamentarians' heads also, because they are so used to it from their countries, because they were colonial powers. It's easier for us maybe than we had one colony, and that's it. And that was a very long time ago. But I think that we have to look more on the consequences and the agriculture and so on, and also a sustainable agriculture, of course. Because if we create something that will give you more difficulties, and sometimes in our own interest, because then they can produce and buy their products, instead of helping you to feed your own population. That should be the goal. You said about the migrants, the displaced person. It's not only climate change, of course, but climate is a multiplying factor. One of the multiplying factors. There's a lot of different causes. And climate, for example, in Syria, was really a multiplying factor. It was a driving factor for the conflict to come afterwards. We had the same, in reality, with the Tunis when the Arabic Spring started. Because of the rising food prices and so on, there was also social unrest. And with the social unrest, then the conflict is there. If you don't try to manage to solve it in a peaceful manner. There was one proposal from the Stockholm Environmental Institute a couple of years ago. It was called Greenhouse Development Rights, where they were looking at different ways of who is going to pay. And for example, in India, then with a 300 million middle class that are over the level of what is sustainable per capita, that part India should have to contribute also. But those who are under, not. It was a way of trying to make also the developing countries understand that if you do just because you can, because you are many and you are still under the line, the threshold, you can do whatever you want. But as a rich Indian or a rich Brazilian or a rich somewhere else, it's also important to understand that I, as a rich person, I have a responsibility. And I have to be just with other in my own country also, and not take all of the resources, the energy resources, for myself. So I think that clean energy is the solution in this case, and then also that we look at our own way of living. We have to look at what do I do? Do I use materials many times, or do I use it once and I just throw it away? Yeah? There's so many things that we can do to reduce the emissions. That was a very long answer.
So I will get back to you, and hopefully I can open up the floor. But these days we've been talking a lot about having access to the spaces and the structures. And you said them in the European Union. We are the European Union. You are the European Union. So it's us now. As a parliamentarian, how do you and the like-minded try to make an effort to open up the spaces? I mean, we know the negotiations, the high negotiations, they are very technical spaces, and it's not easy to be there without all the preparation. But it's like, how do you sort of build alliances with social movements from the south to actually influence these negotiations and other spaces where these discussions are held. And I have another question for you as well. And that was, none of you raised the feminist perspective on this. And I'm quite surprised, because we spent all day yesterday talking about what a feminist foreign policy is, and we talked about, very briefly, but we also mentioned climate. So, from your perspective, because you also, in a way, represent the Swedish government, that is a government that has pronounced itself as a feminist government, and also we have a foreign minister who said that her first declaration that we will have a feminist foreign policy. And when you put that into the context of working on climate justice, what does it mean? Just brief answer. And then
the first one about the what do we do? From the Green Group, we have a lot. Was it some?
Yes.
From the Green Group, we have a lot of interaction with civil society to start with, and we have also a home page, a climate change page now before the COP21. What the other ones do, I do not really know what the other groups do, but as the Green Group, we have a lot of interaction with civil society, both in Europe and outside. And then when it comes to what do we talk about with the governments, we have the possibility to talk with a lot of governments, of course. And I, especially when I'm in the ACP delegation, I used to talk to other parliamentarians or presidents or ministers and so on. And I tell them that they have to be tough in the negotiations. That they cannot just believe that the Europe will stand up for higher standards if they do not put pressure. Yeah? So anyway, for me, it has been, I want to make alliance. I want to make the countries understand and the parliamentarians that they have to be very strong in these negotiations. They can't trust us only. I do not trust our commissioner. They should not do it either. They should put a lot of pressure, because if you put a lot of pressure, then we can put a lot of pressure also. So that's also the link between us and the parliamentarians and the civil society. The feministic one. The first thing I thought when I saw you were three respondents, main respondents. Is this possible? Is this possible in Sweden? But it is. Okay, I'm a woman, so we are four, and 25% are women. But yeah, when we talk about the Swedish feminist perspective, and that was also the former government, in a way. In the cooperation, we have a very specific target. We target really women. We do believe that acting through women, we can reach much better results. Because women are different, I think. So when this is one of the main pillars really in the Swedish cooperation, to work through women to get results on climate and on poverty reduction and so on. And especially, I know that the civil society works very much in this way. And I think also from the European Union, we talk much more about it now than we did before. We have now Federica Mogherini. She's the High Representative for the European Union in the External Affairs, and she and Margot Wallström, they are also good friends. And so it's much more focused on women now in External Affairs, also on the European level, and that's
okay. But my question was on climate justice, but I will not allow you, because I want Sukanta to come in again and see some reflection on that, and maybe you could also help us to see what is climate and gender justice together.
Yeah, of course, actually I also wrote that question is that I wanted to ask, because as you heard about your feminist policy, foreign policy, and when you talk about the climate justice or climate change, the old victims is the women and children. When there is a war, it is also the women and children. And in Bangladesh or other vulnerable country, and also mentioned, is Bangladesh one of the most vulnerable countries that there will be more victims due to the climate change if it is happened to us. It is happened, but in different way. So how the women and children in Bangladesh, especially those who will be the victims of this problem, how they can get justice? Because as we have climate justice, and also the foreign policy, the feminist foreign policy is more strong than one now. And how also, and you can imagine how it is linked, and how the people, especially the women and children, can get justice is okay due to, as you have your own foreign policy.
I was feeling, you know, you talked about just the 300 million and their aspirations. I think the other part of the story is that we have over 600 million who are involved in rural livelihoods, and they are involved primarily in agriculture and forest-related activities, and where the impact is maximum on them. And we're seeing it in just in our district, where we're seeing it over the last 4 or 5 years, where earlier you could predict literally everything that could happen. One of the main the communities that we work with, they collect honey, and you could predict the cycle very rigorously every year. Today, for those communities, they are impacted so badly when there is a nearly over 1,000% difference in the produce that they get from 1 year to the next. And so their livelihoods, how it gets impacted. The kinds of things that they collect from forests, which primarily women do, more than 70% of the collectors of forest produce in our country are women and children. And when this kind of impact takes place, they are the most vulnerable, because they have no means of livelihood at that point of time. In many of the areas, we have an issue of migration where the garment industry pulls away a huge number of men, and then the women and children are left alone at home to be able to deal with these things. So this set, which is I just gave a microcosm in our place, but the 600 million people, for them, the impact is extremely high, and they are just left to the forces when the impact comes, and they have absolutely no mechanism to deal with it, because for them this is the only means of livelihood, whatever they are doing, and that also is split over different months of the year. It's not one. And it's split over different things that they do. They go for labor in plantations, they collect, produce, they work in the fields, and they do the household activities. And so the impact on these people is huge. And so the 600 million people, for what is the options for them? What are the options for them? It's something that we have to deal with.
Yeah, this time I'd like to come to a broader perspective. What you said, it is very good to hear. I also observe about the student, you are changing your use of fossil fuel or technology or lifestyle, many things, which is very important. For reducing the carbon emission, what is demanded by the country like us, that the rich country who are affecting or contributing much to climate change should reduce the carbon emission. Unfortunately, the country, following what, from where we are going back, we are following the bad things you had earlier. For example, India, China are contributing much, but they are not shifting their way of development. And this. What important things I look at this kind of negotiations and solutions, which is trade interest. Allow the country like European countries, which has improved technology, they look for how they can sell the technology to the country like us. I also see the colonial attitude in this case also. In this situation at global level, what moderator said that the people, we, the Swedish people, the Green Party, this kind of who has influence in policy, directly involved in policy and the civil society, we should have some connection and common action to have bigger voice against these, all this. Thank you.
Okay, I think that on the two first questions, because yes, on the 600,000 in the countryside, and in reality, they should have the possibility to be middle class also. Yeah? In reality, they are the most affected because of the predictability in the harvest and so on. I understood what you said. And this is something that I've seen before. Also, I went to Mali a couple of years ago, and then they told me, well, before, when we were looking at the sky, and when the birds came, we knew that it's time to plant our seeds, and in a week, then the rain will come. But now it doesn't function like that. So there the Swedish corporation entered with some irrigation and other adaptation measures to make it possible for them to produce their own food, even in the future. I think that we have to, both for Bangladesh and for, we have to work a lot of adaptation. I didn't talk so much about it before, but that is one of the pillars. It's not only to reduce our emissions, we have also to adapt to the already changing climate. And because we know that some consequences will be there, and that if we are going to be able to live still in our area, maybe we have, it's different in different ways, in different places. Maybe we have to build something that so the water doesn't come there, or we have to build something so the water can come. So we have to adapt our livelihoods or the place where we live so it can resist the climate change. So we can, so women, children can live there still in the future, and men, of course. So I think, but we know that women are the most vulnerable in climate change. And that's the statistics, we can see that. And we have to work very much on helping women in their neighborhood to stay. But the adaptation measures are very, very important. In Vietnam, they decided that they would have 1% of the yearly budget to combat climate, the consequences of climate change, and that was in 2007 or 8 or something like that. Because they said, well, the sea level will rise, so we have to adapt to the changing climate. And that is what the governments should do. They should do it now and not wait. And there, it's every government has the obligation to protect their own population. And we have a responsibility to contribute to that, because we caused the problem. Yes, you have also responsibility, those who today emit too much now when we know, but the most of the people in Bangladesh or in India, they do not contribute to climate change, very, very little. So it's really up to us, richer ones, rich people in India, rich people in Europe, we have to contribute to that.
And even at our government level, it's now 2.6% of the GDP they have committed towards dealing with climate change, and that's a huge,
very, very good.
Yeah, that's a huge amount.
Especially when I went to India a couple of years ago, and I spoke to the the ministers, and they just said, well, it's your problem, you solve it. So that's a big change. That's good to me.
Yeah, Bangladesh
also gave the climate trust fund. Sukanta, please, the mic.
Bangladesh has developed its own fund, climate trust fund, which from 2007 to 2014 November, nearly spent 29,000 million taka for climate change. So it's okay. Bangladesh government is also trying, but of course we have limitation. We have lots of political problems that we have to face, and
then I think also it's very. It's very normal if Bangladesh, if you have coal and if you have, well, for example, in Mozambique, they have a lot of gas findings. Now, of course, they want to use them to get its economy. I don't understand that. But I, as a green, it should stay in the ground because it's much better in the ground than if we use it. But I do understand perfectly that Mozambique wants to.
I think energy is the biggest crisis in many parts of our country. Even over the last couple of years, we've had an attempt with French and Russian support to be able to start a nuclear plant, and there's been a huge civil society movement against it. But even in spite of that. They're moving ahead. We've had even in some other states where some of the places where you think victory has come, you know, where some of the activities like dams have been stopped. Yeah, but you take 3 years later and the process starts again. And so it's a continuing effort where the civil society, I feel, has to be able to push the government. The government makes a commitment or makes a statement over certain things. But if the civil society dialogue does not happen or cooperation doesn't happen, then it just remains many times just on paper.
Okay. So on that note, Mathew, we need to. Our time is out, and there is a lot of issues that we didn't have time to discuss, but we have a full day today, and maybe just what you entered there is like what are the voices from the social movements and civil society when it comes to the different solutions and might be adaptation or mitigation. You mentioned many times here clean energy. Well, on cost, who is paying the cost for the clean biofuel in Sweden when you're invading lands of indigenous people or you're deporting people, forced deportation because of the building of the dams. And there are so many issues and the whole issue that we just touched briefly upon on food sovereignty and how we combine all these technical solutions also with a human rights perspective and also looking to different groups in society. So, Bodil, thank you for opening the day and giving us some insights how the work is going and moving forward, hopefully, from the European Parliament's perspective, but also what you're doing in the Green Party. Thank you so much for your interventions. Some of you will be back during the day, so we will continue the discussion. But to all of you, a big thank you. And as you noticed, I didn't have time to invite you any questions, but please, there will be other spaces, and if you have some reflections right now, put them in the reflection box, and because we do need your input for the final report for these local development talks.
I also want to thank Bodil with a little present. Which is something very interesting inside, but you will see from Lost Forest that it's a green company that we work together with, but also there is a USB on here where there is a lot of different papers from our partners that they have chosen to put on here, and also a paper that they have written together on food sovereignty, climate change, land rights and gender justice. So we hope that you have possibility to look into that. Thank you so much.